most obvious evidence that the flag was on the moon and not in any air is that whenever people walked by it, it didn't move at all. It only moved when someone was working with the staff or letting go as it rocked back and forth. It didn't billow like it was being hit by a burst of air. It swung back and forth like maybe a sheet of chainmail would. Try it yourself. Try this at home.
But decreased gravity and the lack of atmosphere can't provide an explanation for the next apparent blunder. When the 16-ton Eagle touched down, it should, claim the skeptics, have disturbed the surface of the moon, blowing the top layer of dust away to expose the rock beneath. But the images show footprints clearly imprinted around the base of the spacecraft. Surely the dust would have blown away, or worse.
This enormously powerful jet of flame and heat and gas, it would have easily scooped up an enormous crater. In fact, there was supposition that the crater would have been so big that the lunar lander would have disappeared into it. That's true.
Ralph Frenet has designed a simple experiment to illustrate the point. He's calculated that the landing module would have been approximately 26 times more powerful than a domestic leaf blower. And if a humble leaf blower can leave a crater in a gravel pit, the module with 10,000 pounds of thrust should have made a canyon.
They didn't move dry dust, they didn't move little rocks, they didn't move anything. So the demonstration is to show that this stuff will disappear immediately, and I'll even be able to gouge some kind of a hole. Come here, you, I haven't used you in a long time. Here we go.
According to Ralph Frenet's experiment, the moon, like the gravel pit, wouldn't have stood a chance.
When it actually landed, the dust was all still there. Now, how can that be? You know, if you blow dust away, it goes away, like I just did here. I swept the ground.
But the Eagle had reduced its power to 25% as it glided into land. Its gentle forward motion would have limited its impact on the ground even more. Under closer inspection, some of the photos do reveal that the landing disturbed the fine lunar soil, but not enough to blow away all surrounding dust. But the most intriguing anomaly has to be the absence of the largest, most stunning object seen in space. In a sky untouched by streetlights, atmosphere, or pollution, the view of the night sky should be spectacular. But incredibly, stars appear to be missing from the Apollo photographs.
Back then, fortunately for me and us, who are trying to break this thing out the truth, they took no pictures of the stars.
Bill Kaysing believes that omitting the stars was all part of NASA's deception.
Astronomers could have easily discerned that the star positions were not those that would have appeared in a photograph taken from the moon. So it's another case where they could not fake it, so they simply ignored it. If you were to talk to Aldrin or Armstrong or any of the other Apollo astronauts, they would actually not respond in any way to questions regarding stars.
When you looked up at the sky, could you actually see the stars and the solar corona in spite of the glare?
We were never able to see stars from the lunar surface or on the daylight side of the moon by eye without looking through the optics.
I asked Neil Armstrong whether he saw stars because I knew everybody else was asking. I knew the answer, of course. The point is that their eyes aren't adapted to that.
The human eye reacts to light by closing and opening the iris. In bright light, the iris becomes smaller. In the dark, it widens. On the moon, the eye, like a camera aperture, cannot adjust to the brightness of the lunar surface and the dim light of a twinkling star at the same time.
If you were to stand in a floodlit stadium or under a streetlight in a city, you would have the same effect. If you looked up, you wouldn't see many stars at all.
Even a modern state-of-the-art TV camera can't cope with such extreme contrast. On our moon set, Jay Windley plans to put the whole matter to an exhaustive test and dispute the theory once and for all.
We're going to find out that if we use an identical camera, loaded with identical film, and we shoot pictures of the night sky, we won't get stars. Okay, I'm going to take a shot here. You notice here I'm not using any sort of a viewfinder. I'm just aiming.
With a replica Apollo Hasselblad, Jay took more than 24 photographs and repeated the experiment using a range of other cameras to test the hoax theories. The morning after, the negatives were developed at an independent processing laboratory in Los Angeles.
In our experiment in the desert, we shot a variety of photographs using different film formats. In this 35mm photograph, we see that the shadows of the crew members in our single light source very distinctly converge together. In fact, there's almost a 90-degree difference in the apparent shadow direction. In this photograph here, we see the effects of terrain on the shadows. The hills change the apparent direction of shadows. The astronaut's shadow here falls in one direction. The shadow of the crew falls in yet another direction because of the hill.
These results directly contradict the conspiracy claims.
Like the Apollo astronauts, we had to guess at our focusing distances and our exposure settings. And because we had no viewfinder, we had to guess at the direction the camera was pointing. And you can clearly see that even with those handicaps, we were able to take quite usable photographs. You can immediately see that there are no stars in this photograph, even though the stars were very bright during our experiment. They're simply too dim to be registered on film at the exposure levels that we used to take these photographs.
The evidence appears to be overwhelming. But still, the skeptics refuse to lie down and roll over. A mysterious rock in a notorious Apollo 16 photograph has only added fuel to the fire.
It's a rock that obviously was made out of papier-mâché, and very clearly on the rock is the letter C.
Ralph René believes the C rock was probably the C prop.
Somebody told me that in Hollywood when they do a set, the set manager comes around and drops cards on the ground, and it says A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, or 1 to 10 or whatever. And the prop men, whatever you call these people, they come out and they put that particular prop over the card. But in Hollywood, they're smart enough to turn the thing upside down so you can't see the mark on the prop.
NASA simply claims that this photo was a freak accident, that the C is in fact a hair on the negative. This nitpicking over photographs is irrelevant for magazine publisher Marcus Allen. He's convinced that no photographic film could possibly have survived the journey to the moon and back in the first place.
In an unprotected camera, in unprotected environment, and the films and photographs we have seen as a result of that, demonstrate absolutely no radiation damage whatsoever.
In 1998, IMAX began production on a film about the construction of the International Space Station.
They flew the cameras up in the space shuttle with their magazines attached, and the IMAX cameras take 70mm roll film, incidentally the same film as was used in the Hasselblad still cameras on Apollo. This film had to be protected, and it was carried up in lead-lined boxes.
Radiation may be the final insurmountable obstacle. Not only would it apparently destroy film, it would also kill the astronauts. The Earth's magnetic field shields our planet from high doses of radiation. But beyond this, in space, the conspiracy theorists claim the astronauts' fragile flesh would be bombarded by an arsenal of deadly forces.
The moon is irradiated by the sun constantly with terrible heat. And of course, there's cosmic radiation, and then there are micrometeorites that travel 60,000 miles an hour that would go right through the camera, the film, and of course, the astronauts themselves.
While the odds against a micrometeoroid hitting an astronaut are believed to be extremely low, any puncture would be decidedly uncomfortable.